This show is proudly brought to you by Audio Pub. Hello, Sir Nigel.
Morning, Colonel.
It's time to click into gear, but I think we're on.
There we go. And what a mad musical morning it is here in Melbourne.
It is, sir. What's been going on?
We're expecting the Edge in the store this morning.
Edge and Noel. If he came in, would you say just Edge?
Yes.
Or is it the Edge? Right. Hello, the Edge.
Hello, Mr. The Edge.
Mr. Edge.
Because a giant concert lineup. Any reviews you've heard? I'd heard, you know, the Auckland one in New Zealand was probably one of their best in a long, long time.
Wow. I quickly had a look at the paper this morning and I just looked at the headline. It said sort of classic.
Yeah. So, maybe one of our listeners who are on already went to it last night.
Did anyone go to the U2 Noel Gallagher gig last night at Etihad? Was it Etihad?
Yes. Well, Etihad. Not Etihad anymore. It's called Marvel Stadium now.
It's Marvel Stadium.
Catch up with the times, girl.
I'm way out of it. Speaking of packing out stadiums, yes. Sir Nigel, one of my Russian spies.
Wow.
Actually, I think he's a Lebanese spy. Yep. He sent me a video of you with a pro band.
That would be Mr. Abood,
Mr. Abood, yes. Sir.
He's
yes,
not
sir.
A very good spy if I know him.
He looked like he was right up the front, so...
Yes.
Spy level low.
I had a wonderful gig myself. It wasn't at U2 or Noel Gallagher levels, I have to say. Mm. But I did that thing that I think is my philosophy in life, is when, even if you're a bit terrible at something, and you know, but enthusiastic, surround yourself with people who are very good.
Yes.
And so I built a super band to...
Unless you're fighting in the UFC.
Yeah, maybe then you're the weak link, and that's not so
don't
good.
Do that.
Yeah. It's and... So, as my farewell from the REA group, I am no longer an employee of the Murdoch Empire.
Yes.
I have retired, and I had surrounded myself with the best players I could find. So, the Lovefish rhythm section.
Yes, yes. They're good, those guys.
They were, and for once in his life, Alan Geordie Leslie wasn't the most hungover person in the room.
Wow. That's a huge statement.
But Ben and Noah's year 12 finished on Thursday.
Wow.
Finished with a bang, finished with a bit of a party at our house. I think Ben was passed out by about 12:30.
Oh.
Found him the next morning. And
kids don't know how to rock anymore.
They managed to get themselves in shape for a rockin' gig at 5 o'clock last night. Our wonderful extended family... Tammy the Spotify star.
Yeah.
She rescued it with a quality Jesus Just Left Chicago.
Is that her real hair now? Is that,
yes, that's that her is, actual hair, yeah. Wow. No longer short, spiky, pixie, kind of man thing. She's a quality musician these days.
The Greg Allman hairdo.
Yeah.
Looks cool.
And it was double corduroy. Now, this is what... See, how much corduroy have you got in your wardrobe, Colonel?
Sadly, I have none anymore.
You have none?
No.
I reckon you were a double corduroy boy back in Brisbane.
I had a lot of corduroy in Brisbane. I did, in the 90s.
Yeah.
I definitely did. I had a selection of corduroy brown slacks.
That girl was rocking double corduroy, and I just go, okay, I don't live that side of the river. I don't know a thing. I'm a...
And what songs did you do? King B?
Nah, opened with, for those Northsiders,
yes.
Bohemian Like You.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
With Danny Warhol's. That song's aged so well.
That's a good track. That's really cool.
And because like all the millennials think it was written for them.
No.
You know, because it's exactly the same human behaviours. Then we got Dirty with King B.
Yes.
Had originally planned for Tammy to sing that, and then... in F, which is what the Stone Foxes do, to give it a really sort of threatening, dirty edge.
Yes.
It wasn't sounding good. She didn't go down that far. So I accidentally sang that one too.
Yes.
That's a fun arrangement. That is all the distort. Mm. So Noah got to use his JHS.
All right.
Russian fuzz. Russian Soviet fuzz. Bought from our good friends around the corner at Deluxe.
Oh, Deluxe, yes. They are the pedal kings.
It's got a special bass switch in it. And my goodness, is that the sound. That was the sound.
It's a big sound.
It wasn't. It's not a Lovefish sound, so it was great to hear it that you got to use that. Then Jesus just left Chicago.
Yes.
That was ZZ fantastic.
Top. The
thanks,
top.
Thanks for trying to show me that last week, by the way.
That's all right.
Alan will let me play that.
Alan, he's very controlling.
He said, you shit at it. You shite, man.
Oh.
Yeah.
And I was trying to figure out what you were saying, and then I thought, oh, yeah, it's Alan.
Geordie.
He's at the airport watching us. He just tuned in. He's on his way to the...
He's off to Japan to buy an R9.
He's going deep into the Orient.
Yeah.
I'll leave it at that.
So, you know, there's always a way in a band with guitars. That's what I think I absolutely love about them is... I just kind of I chugged away. We sort of did an A because again Tam's voice is a little higher.
Yes.
And I just chugged away on an A and a power chord with all the distortion. He did all the twinkly bits and it sounded fabulous.
Well, it looked good.
And then we finished with the Australian national anthem.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know you did that. Okay.
The Angels. Am I ever going to see your face again?
That's what I was referring to.
Which now, I think should be the song sung at every gig.
Yes.
You know, that is...
Hand on your heart. You
a
know,
lot of audience participation.
Koala bear on your shoulder.
And
a tinny in your hand.
Yeah.
And ready to chuck.
Very appropriate when you're leaving the company.
I know. You seem very relaxed today, I have to say.
I'm probably 20 kilos lighter, I reckon.
It looked good. It certainly looked good. Young Nat sent me a video... late last night.
I prefer the photos, Colonel, because...
the video was king bee. It sounded good.
Yeah, I kind of
sounded good.
I bring the Ramones kind of stylings to these beautiful songs.
Well...
Shouting kind
of. Speaking of Ramones, yeah. I think I have my facts right. The gentleman behind us on the wall,
yes.
Young Phil Spector, I think he did a Ramones album.
Because we're on episode 3 of this dark, dark story arc, which we have referred to as...
Are you ready? Rock and Roll Murders. Spooky.
Look, the clear winner in episode 1 was Charles Manson with North of 12.
Man.
But it's a very stacked field in the following medal positions.
Charles Manson is good for our ratings.
Yes, it was. And Sid Vicious got the silver medal. He got to appear last week. One murder, two attempted.
Pretty
and,
good.
And this week with an equivalent one murder, two attempted, but quite a lot of domestic violence.
Phil
Spector.
My goodness. Now, as we all know, Nigel... You were there. You were there with Sid, and you were there with...
It was, you know, Spector was the early...
Spector.
The early 60s was my... I was born.
Mm.
Yeah, around 63, he was at his peak. And that, we have to... Like, how old was Sid?
He was... When he died?
Yeah.
I think he was 21.
21. So, that's an interesting coincidence, because we've got a person at their peak at 21, and then we've got Phil Spector... Born in 1939, at 21, 1963.
Same age as my mum.
He's peaking. Like, he's just turning into this auteur, they use this fancy word.
Incredible.
He can write, he can play, he can organise, he's got the commercial side of it. And he is also a complete...
Lunatic.
Yeah. Psychopathic lunatic.
Well,
he wasn't active for that long, and it took him quite a long time to do the murder. That was 2004.
Yes.
He's well known to have a freakish fascination with handguns.
Yes.
And
as you can see,
held many a handgun to the head of many a musical artist, including the Ramones.
I also heard he shot a gun. Right beside the ear of John Lennon. Is that... I think I read that somewhere. He brought a gun to the studio and...
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's the thing. I think a lot of people did albums with him without knowing what a psychopath he was, because he created this orchestral wall of sound.
Yes. Yes, he did. Now, so Nigel, we're going to have a couple of...
We've got some more people online.
We got some more people. We're going to do some Phil Spector-produced wall of soundtracks. We're going to talk guitars.
But there's only two of us, so how are we going to do a wall of sound?
Then we'll have a little wall of sound behind us.
Yeah.
Alan Leslie is on, of course, at the airport. He's going to Japan for a couple of years of guitar shopping.
Yes, marvellous.
So his lovely partner will be thrilled about that. Michael Ray is on. Hello, Michael Ray. out in the leafy east. Gregory Lambert. G'day, chaps. Keep on rocking.
Yes.
Gregory Lambert.
That's
hello,
what
Gregory.
Saturday mornings are for.
And Paul D. Paul D is on. Now,
Did I see something? Did I see something?
Paul D, you have a problem. And that problem is, hang on, guitar acquisition syndrome.
Mm. Gas.
Gas.
Paul has gas.
Boy, oh boy.
Yeah, he's got good taste, though.
Alan, in case you haven't seen it, we should do a show with Paul's new mint condition
1957
triple pickup Black Beauty.
Yeah, that's a really important. It's a really important guitar in the series, from the gold top to the whole burst era. If you that was Les Paul's guitar.
Unbelievable, incredible. Now, what have you got in your hands there?
Well, I have chosen a miracle guitar of my own.
Yes,
it just looks like it, probably to the, you know, 1080p viewers, an ordinary kind of caramelly coloured, honey coloured telly.
Yes.
But it is not. It is a Hahn.
Hahn.
And you know what?
Go.
This dad joke just tells itself, doesn't it?
What have you got there, Nigel? A Hahn?
Am I allowed to do a solo this morning?
Do you mean a Hahn solo? Of course you are. It's your lightsaber.
Do you know what's magic about this guitar?
Yes.
It's not only the fact that it is finished within an inch of its life to perfection.
Because sure
I think this is the only headstock that's any good outside of Fender.
Yeah,
They've
I agree.
Actually, this scalloped piece here, and modern, they did it. So many headstocks on those secondary brands are appalling.
They've done it beautifully. He's a builder out of, I think, New York.
So, Colonel, we start talking about murderous guitarists.
Yes, we do.
And all their victims, the Manson family victims, the Nancy Spungen, and the actress killed by the horrific Phil Spector.
Yes.
And the power goes out. Is this a coincidence?
Yes.
Is it spooky?
It's very spooky. And
Is it Bob the electrician downstairs?
No, it's Bob the electrician downstairs. Vodafone, who are our lovely neighbours, have decided to move out today. And so they're going, and Bob the electrician is down there, and he just switched off all the power to the entire building here. So, but anyway.
As you do.
We're back. Where were we?
We were discussing, Phil Spector.
Phil Spector. Guitars. Should we do a song?
We should, let's do something from his infamous wall of sound with our two guitars. You are probably going to just about explain what your Fender Stratocaster.
Ah, yes.
Which I couldn't play because it blended into my shirt.
It literally is the same color as your shirt. That would have been cool, though. This is a wine red. It's a rare color for a Strat. Wine red Strat from 1996. With lace sensor pickups, which came standard.
What's
on
a lace
some
sensor?
That's like a noiseless pickup system.
Yeah.
And Fender had a contract with that company, and then they got rid of the company. But these pickups were in the Clapton Strats, the original Clapton Strats from 1989. So I think lace sensors and Fender sort of go between 1989 and 1996, 1997.
Do you like them?
They're okay. They're okay. Let's have a bit of a listen.
Yeah, give us some.
It's very nice and clean.
Certainly the lack of hum is pleasant.
It's very nice and sweet.
Right.
It's a delicate sound.
I don't think Jimi Hendrix would like them.
No. Well, this is the thing. The new Fender, now what's the new name of it? I've forgotten the model. But of course, they're all noiseless pickups now.
Right.
So, and a few traditionalists have gone, I don't know about that.
It's practical because the noise can be annoying at jamming and rehearsal and equally when broadcasting. So that is the ideal.
When Bob the Builder switched off the whole.
That's the broadcasting one.
He flicked off our wall of sound.
He did.
At the wall.
Yes.
So now, Nigel.
So
Michael Ray's back.
Well, thank
Alan
goodness.
Back.
They've obviously figured out what was going on.
Yes.
But it was very creepy with Phil Spector holding a gun to our heads.
That I love that picture out. Though. I need a t-shirt like that. So.
Oh man, he's terrible. And
he's a bad guy.
I'll be debuting my new t-shirt because one of my wonderful farewell gifts was from my good friends at Orange Sky Laundry.
Yeah.
Who are beautiful people.
Yes.
They have an amazing helping service and I'm a big fan and I will support them forever. They're very clever with their art and their printing because they're millennial.
Yeah.
And they made us a set of band t-shirts.
Did they?
Yeah.
That's nice.
And then I left them at work. I thought I was going to wear it this morning. But
that's all right.
That's for next week's show.
They up in Brisbane, those guys?
Yes, they are. Yeah, in Albion, in Brisbane.
Oh, Albion. I used to work in Albion.
It's
there you go.
A funky little suburb.
It is funky now.
It's got a brewery, a distillery, coffee grind, roasting and...
That is a very old industrial suburb that, I mean, I haven't lived there for 20 years, but I drove through it, I reckon earlier this year when I was up in February. I drove through Albion. It's changed. It's totally different. So,
yeah.
But when I worked there,
I'm encouraging men to get a band together. I think they've got an amazing warehouse for rehearsals. But okay, so now this is problematic because Spector's well known for using one of the greatest kind of musical studio setups, the Wrecking Crew. I've seen the Wrecking Crew movie and I just happen to know that A, they're really good, B, they play a lot of open chords.
Yes, they do.
And C, their timing is immaculate. So
Hal Blaine on drums.
What is going to happen to me this morning? Have you picked some simple ones?
I have, but I've picked your kryptonite a little bit, and that is open chords. But I've got a capo. Oh, we've got a capo song. So it makes it a tiny little bit easier.
Well, no, so it's good practice.
Let's have a look at Do Ron Ron.
Oh, I'm not, yeah, that's right.
The capo on three. And finally, have you listened to the words of this song?
This is the Ronettes. This is the huge song. This is huge for Spector.
And the singer, the lead singer, married Phil Spector.
Well, he was, doing the dirty on his first wife with... for a long time.
Oh, right. Yeah, he's a monster.
That's the sort of character he is.
And apparently he made them... this song is about him. It's about him. Met him... What is it? Met him on a Monday. His name was Phil. So, anyway.
But this is a very early example of the sound, the wall of sound getting filled in.
Yes.
So you got a capo?
I've got a capo, sir.
So what's a capo name? What was this named after? Because we're saying it wrong.
Okay, it was named after the first Italian-American mobster is that correct?
It is named after an Italian mobster. It's the capo, who is the head of the mafia. It goes on the head of the guitar.
There we go. That sounds right.
And then, you have the capo di capo, which is the head of the boss of the bosses.
Cappuccino.
Yeah.
It's delicious.
Yeah.
We have some extra people on.
Thank goodness.
If you've just tuned in, we had a power blackout. Bob the Builder.
Yeah, we had a spooky Phil Spector creepy power blackout.
Alan says, have you not been paying your electricity bills again, Kurt? Pretty much.
No.
We tapped into the... I've set up my own system here. There's a large cable going out the window. Amanda Smith is on. Good to see Amanda Smith. We haven't seen her in a while. Ross Kavanagh is on.
An ounce of diversity amongst our crew.
Rob Manger. Okay, we're going to do Ron.
He played fabulously last
night. I saw a photo of Rob. I didn't see a video. My spy was probably drinking beer.
I was so honoured that they pulled it back together. Some of the set from the Battle of the Bands winning set. Jeepers, he's lost nothing. And he's got a lovely wine coloured, just like that. Les Paul was on fire.
I mostly pretend not to know Rob until he wins a competition, and then I love him.
The truth. I'm sure you're responsible for everything.
Of course, I take full credit. Yeah. We're going to do because we're short on time. We're going to do a song, and then we're going to come back and talk about what happened to Lana Clarkson.
Yeah,
and Nigel was there.
Grizzly murder.
A grizzly murder. Okay, folks, this is
Somebody.
Do Ron.
I bet you it's fast. And it's got a C, an F, a G, and a C, which are cool chords.
Do Ron Ron. Come on, Ronettes.
On my lovely Han.
I do run, run. Ronettes, where are you? Ronettes. Oh my God.
That's my reggae version of it, folks.
It's being naughty today.
Wow.
We may not have the license to this. Okay.
Oh.
What's going on?
You lost the license. Maybe Spector didn't...
What?
What a crazy guy, though, that he can go from, in terms of a spectrum of Spector, we're going from this, the Ronettes, to the Ramones.
Yeah, I know. Which Ramones album did he do?
One of their last ones.
Wrong. Crystals.
No, they didn't love working with him, as most people found him quite controlling and... That'll happen when somebody points a gun in your face.
Da do Ron Ron. Oh, you know what? I think this is actually the Crystals and not the Ronettes.
Oh, shit.
I've got that wrong.
Me too.
We need a corrections corner for next week.
Yeah.
Like the My Favorite Murder Girls in LA. I like that. All right. Well, we're going to try it. Da do Ron Ron.
That's why you couldn't find it.
I know. That's ridiculous. Da do.
This is the 60s.
All right. Here we go, folks. Dun, da, da, dun, dun, dun.
Right.
Uh-huh. Right. Do we have...
We've just got technical... Nat, where are you?
It's a technical nightmare.
We need Nat Abood, actually.
Nat!
Do you know who we need?
Yes.
Hello, sir. I had such help yesterday from our kind of young video guru.
Yes.
Jordan.
Who's your video guru?
Jordan. Cake, and as we call him, and... Man, there's just nothing he doesn't know about live video and music. And
young people today, like he's they're unbelievable.
Just one of those. You just, I stood there amidst a pile of backline, going, "Oh my God, I got babies to hug. I've got everything to do going out there." He said, "I'll take care of it."
Yes.
And 5 minutes later, it was professionally taped to the floor and perfectly balanced.
It's incredible.
He's a magician.
We'll have to get him in. I think we're ready to go now. All okay. Right. Take two.
Oh, wow, listen to the fuzz on that. That's tricky.
That is tricky. I'm glad we practiced that one.
I tell you.
Otherwise, God knows what would
happen. I tell you what, if you're looking for a fun exercise to change from C to F to G, that's the song.
Yes. If you're wondering why we're using capos and you want to play along with... Oh, give me some sound.
I can't even hear my guitar, Colonel. I'm not...
Oh. Yeah, you're there.
I'm there?
You were there.
All right.
I've got us down. I've got us down a bit low today. It was an emergency mix. If we didn't have a capo, I'd have to play that in D sharp or E flat. That song is in E flat.
Oh, that's it.
So we can do it.
No.
There's my E flat. There it is. But sometimes, and we can do that, Nigel can do that, there's no problem. But sometimes it's just easier to put a capo on. And if I play a C shape, so if I put my capo on three.
What's a C? Is it G?
There's my C shape. Well, is the C is an E flat now, right? In a C shape.
Yeah.
This is why when you go and see a pub player or busker, I'm not putting them down. But they use capos a lot because it just makes life easy. So you can play, you can learn your open chords. All that sort of stuff.
You get such
and
a,
move the capo around.
Look, there's no question. I will admit it right now that an open chord makes a much bigger sound.
It certainly does.
Worth knowing those things.
Absolutely.
I tell you what, did we stay online? Or did the Spector of Phil Spector run us offline as well?
Has he taken us away? Well, let's have a look. Yes, we are.
Ooh, that's kind of cool. Right.
Now, Nigel.
What else?
Let's go back to the early 2000s. You were out at a bar in LA having a drink.
Yeah, I was. A scary thing, I was in America at that time.
There you go. And you ran into Phil. Now, what happened?
So, well, Phil's had a few.
Yeah.
His wig is askew.
Does anyone know which wig it was?
I don't know, probably the big one, the big F, you know.
The one in the...
This is what, I think this is part of what made him a very sick fellow, was going through the windscreen of a car in Los Angeles in the late 60s maybe, or early 70s, because he didn't have his seatbelt on. There's a lesson for your children.
Yeah.
I reckon a bit of brain damage, and, you know, apparently took 300 stitches in his face
to
repair
Lord.
Him. And that was the end of his already fading hairline. So he just sacrificed the hair for a wig, which you're going to have to do at some stage, Colonel.
I need a wig.
It's going to happen.
I get the, I'm going to look online and get the Phil Spector limited edition wigs.
Yeah, well, he had hundreds. And was absolutely brazen about wearing them, and even wore one to his induction to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
Oh, right. I haven't seen that.
Oh, my God.
Which one was it?
No, it's just a shocker.
Dear.
Anyway, so there he is, wigging out, drinking too much. He's Phil No Mates, and he eventually takes home one of the bar staff, who's clearly had a few herself, to think that he was an attractive fellow. misses the fact that he's a psychopath.
Yes.
And she's found dead in the morning with a kind of... clearly a very terrible gun accident. Accident. Phil shot her in the face. Almost.
Right.
So in the panic phone call to the ambulance, he's heard saying this.
Yes.
I've shot her. Then, of course, does the usual...
I didn't...
Well, he really does the Sid Vicious.
Right.
I don't remember anything, Your Honour.
Yeah.
And he's getting his driver to cover up from it, and it's a terrible thing. So... there's some interesting connections between all of our murderers. And that's something someone was telling me about this week. Did you know?
Yeah.
Actually. A bit of mansplaining for us.
Mansplaining.
What's any mansplaining going on online there? Have we been corrected for our...
oh, my God. We've got a lot of people on. Mark Teague.
Thank goodness. Welcome back, everyone.
Ross listening in stereo. Oh, yeah.
This sort of thing doesn't
happen. I mean, in mono.
This never happened on Channel 9.
they have a big battery. I should ask, if anyone knows, hey, I have a question for you, Ross Kavanagh, ABC, lefty. If you have a blackout, how does that work? Do you have a massive generator there?
Must do.
Yeah, tell us about that story.
We need them in all the kind of, what a terrible week for fires and things. We're deeply reliant on the media.
We are.
And finally, so they do need,
especially the ABC,
definitely the backups. But no, so here's some lovely connections. And so, pop quiz.
I love the positive twist we have to these stories.
We've got to put some life into these murders.
Let's do it.
So, convicted murderer and glasser in the face of Patti Smith's brother, Sid Vicious, was reading the history of the biography of which person in jail in his 57 days on Riker Island.
Now, you sent me a message and I know the answer. Should we leave that as a quiz or should we just say
No, we just tell them.
We'll just tell them.
He was reading Helter Skelter, which is the story of the Manson family. So a very nasty connection.
Yeah.
Now, which Wilson brother liked Charles Manson?
Well, that's Dennis Wilson.
Dennis, the not very good judge of character.
Poor.
What happened? Yeah, poor. Did Brian like him?
No.
So Brian's a good judge of character because Brian didn't like Phil Spector either. And a tremendous hatred set up between these two.
Wow. Because I know Brian Wilson went pretty well, he went crazy, but listening to Be My Baby.
Yes, exactly.
Over and over again.
And what song did he create that's remarkably similar?
Oh, damn.
So the tapes of his drug-fueled rambling about Be My Baby, Phil Spector, what a nut bar he is, but how does he create this wall of sound?
Yeah.
They were discovered by a biographer.
Oh.
Like it's just hours and hours of him in a darkened room. You know the song Don't Worry Baby?
Yes.
That's his response to it.
Don't worry. I got married to Don't Worry Baby.
And Spector.
Nat will remember that.
Yeah, and Spector was absolutely brutal to Brian Wilson. Like, he got him in at one stage going, oh, no, it's all good between us, man.
Wow.
Brian wrote a couple of songs for him. He said, come in and play the keys on the recording. And, you know, love you, dude, love you, come in and do that. And he's like four takes through and he goes, nah, you're terrible, you're useless, you can't play.
Wow.
Here's your award wages for 2 hours and 13 minutes. Be out of here, you terrible musician.
Wow.
And all of this really impacts Mr. Wilson's mental state. Wow. So that was a very awful. Much, so there's a weird connection between Manson and all of our people.
That's incredible. Oh, my God.
But hello. What, have we got another song from Phil Spector?
So we've got time for another song. And, well, tell me this. You mentioned before, Sir Nigel, attempted murders by Mr. Spector.
Yeah.
What happened?
He shot a couple of people.
Okay.
No, I don't know how. I mean, I guess they pay their way out of it.
Yes.
So,
I think so, yeah. He's got a lot of money.
Shooting people. But never prosecuted.
Well, I think
and
there's this
like some early kind of
LA,
batterings and violence, and he is a man of zero ethics.
Right. I think he was very, very bad to Ronnie Spector. I think
and terrible to his employers. You know that he would he got varying jobs at varying times, and he would steal artists, record them on the side in another studio, quit, and release the recordings. And by manipulating the artists, they didn't know they were doing something wrong.
Aye.
And I don't quite understand how he got so close to so many amazing artists. Leonard Cohen, the leftover Beatles. What's the Beatles album he mixed?
Let It Be.
And which is actually quite lovely.
It's great. I like what he did on that record, but then they released Let It Be Naked because they wanted it that way. But
and then he goes on to actually have quite the career with Harrison and Lennon.
Yes.
And that,
yes,
that was
does.
A bit of a revitalization.
Did John Lennon's... Did you Imagine? I think he might have done the Imagine album.
Yeah, he won several Grammys for all that period. But yeah, unbelievable... manipulator and psychopath. Colonel, I've just had a shock. I've just had a momentary shock.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Because I've seen something on your table over there and it looks a lot like a cassette tape.
Yes,
did that power warp cause a time warp in here?
What I'm doing...
Have we gone back to the... grab that cassette. I want to see it.
Mm.
We're in the 1970s.
If you've
here.
Never seen a cassette tape, that is what they look like.
How does it fit in my eye? Is there a door?
You need an adapter.
Oh, I've got one. It's all right. I peel off the adapter on my iPhone. And we'll pop the cassette in. There it goes.
And sold.
I press play.
Oh, and there it's working.
What is this?
It's an
unlabeled... Is it a mixtape you've made for me for my retirement?
Yes. Well, it's my old band from 25 years ago, and we have some studio stuff, but we also have a lot of eight-track cassette stuff. And back in the day, before before everyone at home had the ability to do it digitally and all that sort of stuff, if you didn't go to a studio and pay Phil Spector a truckload of dough, you basically went and bought a Tascam machine or a Yamaha machine, etc. Yep. And that's what we did. So at the time, we had I think it was quite expensive, it was like a $2,500 Yamaha 8-track tape machine.
Yeah.
And we did all these tapes and then, of course, completely forgot all about it. And so it's 25 years later and I've had them sitting in a back room.
No way.
For 25 years, yes. And
they don't still work, do they?
They do still work. And I went and bought the same machine because you need this exact same Yamaha machine to play those tapes. So I bought it for $100. Used to be $2,500. Now it's $100.
You are a vintage suit.
So I've been doing analog. So there was
stuff on. That would be like an incredible moment, discovering the still stuff on them. Were you nervous?
I was. Well, it brings back odd memories, actually. And to hear yourself from 25 years ago doing things and talking. It's odd. But I will be re-releasing everything. Wow. Coming to a website soon.
Spotify?
Yes. We'll do Spotify.
That's a brilliant idea. Good on you, mate. I can't wait. I'll pay you money for that.
Sold. I'm ready to make my dollar out of 1 million plays.
I love Mahan, but yes. I spotted this.
Ooh.
And wow. It's a gorgeous Gibson 335.
That well, Sir Nigel, it certainly looks like one, but it's actually a history.
What's
brand.
A history?
History is a Japanese brand.
Yeah.
And it's made for a specific guitar shop over there, which I think it's Kurosawa Guitars. I could be totally wrong with that. Corrections Corner next week. And they do Gibson copies for the Japanese market.
And
if you were blindfolded, you would never know. You would never know because that is a very nice guitar.
It is exactly the weight of my Gibson guitar, although my Gibson
guitar... And a third of the price.
So my Gibson guitar is slightly lighter. I'm very sad to report. The little strap locks?
Yes.
That are like 50 cents each. They're the greatest thing in the world. I bought a whole bucket of them because I'm mad about them after that. I had that small accident with my Gibson.
Yes.
And so we were rehearsing yesterday before our gig and I put them on and it's like, I really hate playing this guitar without strap locks, but they've all disappeared. Mm. They've all left the house in the pockets of young guitarists. And I'm going, I'm so nervous about doing this just in case it falls to the floor.
Bang.
This back strap came off. So I have a little bit of a dent on the bottom of the
335. That's all right. You got to do it. That's a beautiful guitar.
It sounds fabulous. So
that's a killer.
Is
that a Yamano one?
No, it's a Memphis one. Ooh. Just as I reach down, pick it up, put this one on, this one falls off.
What?
And I catch it.
Oh.
So this one I didn't catch, it fell on the carpet. This one I caught, otherwise I'd have had a two-piece 335 for the gig yesterday.
Mm. Well, we can always, circle fretting system. It's written on the truss rod cover. How about that? I didn't even notice that before.
Oh, I tell you what, it's beautiful. And I'm happy to play it. And only $1,250 is nuts.
Ross Kavanagh says, we have a big Tesla battery backup.
We need one.
We need one of those.
I'm not coming back until you've got a Tesla battery.
Did you bake them? Okay. Superb guitar, that history. That's what Alan says. All right, shall we finish with the song? I have a feeling.
Yeah, I'm just going to clean. I'm going to clean the history up a tiny bit on the sewer.
Okay, cool.
I had to, and if I can reach.
Let's do River Deep.
I love this song. Wow.
This is another Phil Spector song.
This is kind of the antithesis of anything I could play.
River Deep.
Oh my God.
I think this is another capo one. It's a capo on one.
Thank goodness.
There we go. River Deep, Mountain High, Glee Cast, Ike and Tina Turner. Are you ready, sir?
So, yeah, he didn't like Ike so much, but then he kind of, because Tina was the talented one.
Yes.
But then he shits on Tina at Ike's funeral.
Does he? What did he do?
What an evil man he was.
It's good that he's in jail then. I'm happy
He is. He's 79 years and he's going to be there till he's dead.
If you're watching Phil from jail, you can write a comment in if you like. We're happy with that. I'm just going to stick with this guitar. I'm going to go. I like
you
this one.
And your electrician friends. Okay.
Set up. Oh my God, here we go.
River Deep, Mountain High, one of the greatest songs of all time. I'm not convinced that's on the capo, mate.
I'm not.
I'm not convinced.
This is a different key.
That's a weirdo version of it, but I guess this ensures we won't get thrown off the air for copyright.
Where is Mr.? Oh, I think it's this one. All right, let's try that again.
We'll go back to the end. Here's one back. I prepared earlier.
Here we go. Is this the Phil Spector one? Come on, buddy.
Yeah, listen to that. This is gigantic.
I'm not liking that. I think that brings an end.
What is going on this show? Phil Spector has ruined the show.
Phil, I'm very disappointed in you.
Do you know what we should do? Just listen to that song for a minute, because people might not know.
We're gonna say goodbye, and we'll let Tina Turner take us out. We'll just wave, I think.
I played very briefly. Oh, yes. A beautiful history. Snapshot. I'll do that next week. I hope it's still in the store because you're selling things fast at the moment.
Oh, hang on. I'll put it on in the background. You ready?
Yeah.
Wait a sec. This is just a standard American Strat, but in a beautiful wine red.
Yeah.
Thank you for coming today, Nigel, and a trooper through the blackouts and the
grisly murder.
The grisly murder.
I think we might. Well, we've got one more episode in this story arc.
Yes. And then you're off to New Zealand?
Yeah, so if anybody wants to just start studying up an artist a little older than this lot for next week, they can look at Lead Belly, because we're going to talk all about another tale of rock and roll
murder. Rock and roll murder.
Murder.
Thank you, Nigel. Thanks, folks. We're here all... Well, I'm here all day in the shop.
Yeah, he is.
Very busy.
I'm cleaning up after the gig. I got to come pick everything up.
Noel Gallagher and the Edge are coming in, I'm pretty sure.
Yep.
Come and see us, folks.
Oh, we're out of here. 3, 2, 1.
Ciao.